Hi guys, welcome back to another episode of the Peaceful Challenge. Today we started with a time lapse. We built up both sides of our Wandering Trader trading system. The last episode, I already explained our plan so that we want to use the end gateways to keep trading with the Wandering Traders without locking their trades. So I showed the exploit that we can use there. And what we built up here is just some really nice decoration and a little bit functional part in the middle. This design was, by the way, made by Cubic Meter, fellow SciCraft member that helps out with the whole Wandering Trader project because, yeah, he already made a video about this that I also linked in last episode already. And yeah, he's really interested in this project, so he's helping us out here. All right, so what we got here is basically the end gateway. We will remove the bedrock above and a little contraption. If the player arrives here, then he would get pushed back into the gateway. Right, so at the moment there's still a couple extra blocks here. We will use those to get the Wandering Trader over. But yeah, that's just one side, basically, of the end gateway with a lot of nice decoration around. Let's go through the end gateway real quick and check out the other side. So this is where we will store the Wandering Traders and eventually also normal villagers, because you can use the same exploit to also not lock the normal villagers, which is kind of useful. So, for example, if you at some point get a really good toolsmith that has a pickaxe with efficiency 3, unbreaking 3, and silk touch, which is really hard to get, we could just take that villager from a cell, send him over here, and basically trade with him, and then the player goes through the end gate to the other side without locking the trades. So this is kind of useful because usually the toolsmiths, they only sell you 3 pickaxes, which isn't a lot. Sometimes you just want to make some spare pickaxes, like a shulker box full of them, and then always have to wait until finally reaches the trades. Is kind of annoying. So this is a nice way to get around this issue without having to go through the effort and getting multiple of those really rare toolsmith villagers. Same goes, for example, if you get a really good efficiency 5 book from a librarian. We could also keep trading with that librarian if you send him to the middle, etc. So this is kind of useful to not go through the effort to get multiple villagers. For example, in our fish farm, that didn't really matter that much because those villagers were easy to get. But yeah, here this is then for the villagers that are really rare, and yeah, so we can prevent locking their trades. So the Wandering Traders will actually be stored at the other end because they despawn if you load them. So they have a 40 to 60 minute counter if they're loaded before they would eventually despawn. And there's really nothing you can do. You can't just rename the Wandering Trader, who despawn regardless. So the plan is basically to make a contraption in the overworld, send the Wandering Traders over here, and then we can store them here at the very end of the trading platform. And if you go back to the middle, they're basically unloaded and the counter stops. So this way we could also store some Wandering Traders. And there's also a button here, so we could also send the Wandering Trader back to the end gateway and we could keep trading with him. But the next step is actually getting the Wandering Traders now. We need to build a spawning platform. Alright, so back in the creative world, next step is the Wandering Trader platform. So we did this already about 1.5 years ago in the Skyblock series. Back in 1.14, there was a really nice trick. You could place a bell in the middle of the platform and a Wandering Trader would be attracted by the bell. So would pathfind towards it, and then he could trick him into falling into some water stream, and he gets flushed into a nether portal, and basically this prevents that he would despawn there. We could also directly flush him into an end portal, and he's sent to the end dimension, and also gets unloaded there, so the counter also stops. Unfortunately, a tricky with the bell doesn't work anymore, but the warning trader still should be attracted by an AFK player. So he got a 100 by 100 platform here, because in a radius of 48 blocks, the warning trader would spawn around the player. All right, so the plan would be just to have an AFK player here in the middle, then the warning trader would spawn, try to pathfind towards the player, and then we could use the good old trapdoor trick, into tricking the warning trader to pathfind over a little drop chute, and he would just fall down here, and he gets flushed into the end portal. And of course, the trader yamas would also spawn, but I think it should be quite simple to separate them. So if we maybe make this 3 wide or so, they have a bit more space, then they could fall down here, and then we just flush the warning trader and the yamas over, and we make a gap where only the warning trader would fit through. So let's actually try that out real quick. Can get to work. So I think the armor is so wide, it actually wouldn't fit through a gap where we just have like trapdoors. Try it out real quick. Make it too high so they can't climb up there. Some water. Then some signs here. Stop the water there. And let's try it out, Yama. Yeah, they shouldn't be able to fall down. Is that too wide? And a villager, a warning trader. Kind of great to use a warning trader actually, because I think this might interfere with our results later. It just fits through. Okay, so let's actually try this out. I'm gonna put a couple more trapdoors here. And yeah, the player would just stand here in the middle. Guess we could place some glass blocks around in case eye contact is needed through some glass blocks. And then we have to wait. So I already explained how it works last episode. Usually it takes a couple hours until you actually get a warning trader, around 3 to 4 on average. Alright, let's do a little tick warp and see if we can get some warning traders this way. Okay, so I had this running for over 90 Minecraft days. The moment I don't see any armor, they probably already despawned. Let's actually see if we got some warning traders. So they should have just fallen into the end portal here. And there we go. Got 2 warning traders. So the system is working. Actually, there are even more warning traders. There's a couple invisible ones. So they drank their night vision potion, went to the end. And yeah, you can see the bubbles here. Yeah, here in the corner there's also another one. It seems like we actually got 4. And we're back in survival, where Glots built up the platform over the end portal. Yeah, this stuff is really not rocket science. All you need is really a platform and then little contraption to send the warning trader down to the end portal. Alright, so this has actually been running for quite some time already. And we got a wandering trader that sells gunpowder. So let's head back to the end and trade with him.
Then just crawl into the other portal. Whoops. And try to not go into the water stream immediately. Okay, so basically we will check, since we're going to want a wandering trader, this lamp should be on. So we will hit this button. So that way, when we are finished with him, he will automatically get sent to the wandering trader mm-hmm. storage, not to one of those cells. Mm-hmm. So we can now go get the wandering trader. So we'll need to go out here. We have three slots selected. I'll just use the second one.
So did you change the view distance already?
No, it's still at 12, so that he still gets loaded, because otherwise he wouldn't come over here. It mm-hmm. already would be lower. So, yep, there we can see him coming. So we can already start going back again as soon as we see him. Let's change the view distance. Set it to 5. Because I think Cubic said 7 should be fine, but just in case, it's 5. So you will basically just grab some emeralds. Then stand in the water stream. Click the wandering trader. Wait till you see the redstone chest, the trap chest. Then do the trade. Exit the GUI again. Then hit the redstone chest, and you will get sent over. And then you will have to quickly click the wandering trader again to trade. So you can try to practice the timings now, but don't trade yet because I'm still loading the area. But just to try to get the flow down a little bit. Click him, go through, then you see the chest, then you could trade, and then go out of it and hit the chest just to get pushed over.
Oh, there's not a lot of time.
Yeah. So basically, just a millisecond after you click the redstone chest, you'll have to click the GUI again.
Okay, but it's doable.
Yeah.
So if you miss it, then it's not a big deal.
Yeah. You just need to be careful because sometimes I experienced that because of server, like you just stand here on the gold block for a little bit longer. And if you're in the flow, it's very tempting to just click the trade again. But you will have to wait until you're on the other side because otherwise he will just lock up and he is basically wasted.
Okay.
Okay, so I will disconnect, so it should be fine. Then you could record it if you want to.
Yeah, I'll try it. Yeah, it definitely takes a bit to get used to it, but
yeah.
Pretty good. Or you have a hopper stack. Oh, you really don't have a lot of time to click on a wandering trader, but that's just to optimize it, I guess.
That's practice.
To get used to it.
So basically, once you're done, you would just set the view distance to 12 again and hit the button behind them if the lamp is on.
Okay, I think I got it. I got 80 gunpowder just for now. Yeah. Right, should we send it back? Then we can maybe do that tomorrow. Wait a bit more.
Sure. Okay, I'm coming over now.
Alright, so we got a good supply of gunpowder now. But if you actually want to get rockets in Peaceful, we also need paper to craft the rockets. You might remember I've shown it recently again. We had this little sugarcane farm at our starter island, but it's definitely also not enough to supply us with enough sugarcane. Let's actually design a proper one. Okay, quickly back to creative. Let's design the sugarcane farm. Actually, I want to use the design that I've seen on Francesco's channel, link in the description, using the honey blocks a while ago. So the sugarcane farm looked like this. There were slabs with honey blocks on top and minecarts on top of the slabs. And then you could actually attach a flying machine and break basically the sugarcane with the blocks here. And the minecarts here on top of the slabs would pick it up immediately. It's actually something similar I did a while ago before the introduction of honey blocks using cauldrons. And yeah, I was glitching the minecarts into the cauldrons there. There was always the problem that the minecarts were glitching out after a while. But it seems like the design Francesca came up here with the honey blocks doesn't have this issue. Alright, I'm gonna put in some minecarts and try this out. Okay, so we got some hopper minecarts now on top of the slabs here. Let's see how this is working. Oh, perfect. Yep. The sugarcane is harvested and picked up immediately with the hopper minecarts. Like, we can also see the problem here that I had the last time. Over time, the minecarts just kept glitching out to the front more and more until they actually fell down. Let's see if this also happens with this design here. Oh god, yeah, it's getting really close. I wonder if this is actually quite good, because then they even can pick up the sugarcane items even easier. But yeah, it seems like after a while they don't go forward anymore. Yeah, seems like this is pretty stable. Okay, I'm pretty sure if I need to stop this, I probably need to place blocks the height of the minecarts all the way. Yeah, exactly, so they get realigned in the middle of the block. Then I could send this whole machine to the other direction. I think this is a pretty good sugarcane farm, actually. Yeah. Breaking your blocks and harvesting with the same flying machine is always something I like. Another alternative is, of course, to have hopper minecarts blow the whole system and picking it up, but they need to place down rails and whatnot. This is so much more convenient always. Alright, I'm gonna make a larger farm out of this. Shouldn't be too large, just large enough so we get enough paper for the rockets. Okay, it's finally done. I got a bit distracted the last couple days and couldn't really finish the sugarcane farm. Also, we couldn't finish the rocket crafting in time for New Year's Eve. But we actually have a second date in mind now. We wanna actually make a little fireworks show. So Helga is from Iceland and she said they also celebrate with fireworks on the 6th of January. So the goal is now to get fireworks until that date. Right, so yeah, this is the sugarcane farm again. It produces about 8,500 sugarcane per hour, so pretty much hopper speed, which makes things a bit easier. Then there's a couple extra things here in the back, like sugar and paper crafting. I would say we build this up at the beginning of the next episode and then also explain it a bit more, what's going on here. All right, that's it for today. Thanks guys for watching and see you next time. Bye bye.